If I count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I simply ask for a favor from Him beyond mortal king. And I'm sure that He'd grant it again. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. So many places of beauty we long to see here below, but time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of the rapture, together we'll stand anew. While I stroll over heaven with you, I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you.
Listen, if you will, to words of comfort and assurance and perhaps even challenge that come from the very heart of God. The psalmist said, I waited patiently for the Lord, and He inclined unto me and heard my cry. Brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, set my feet upon a rock, and established my goings. The words of the great apostle. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of all mercies, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in our affliction, that we may be able to then comfort those that are in any affliction through the comfort wherewith we ourselves have been comforted of God. And then the words of the prophet, when thou passest through the waters, I'll be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. Best not ever a welcomed event. Doesn't make any difference how it comes or under what circumstance, and so often it's untimely in its arrival. And if we focus on that fact, if we focus on the reality of the death and the fact that death's invaded our ranks, then that leads us to despair and discouragement. It imposes upon us. And so I don't want our focus to be on the fact that Milton's gone. Our focus needs to be on the fact that Milton was here, that he was in the middle of us. More in the middle of us than we wanted to. But he was definitely among us. And that's what's important. He was known in many different ways. He was husband, father, grandfather, brother. He was big. And he didn't like it when I referred to him as that. And his life centered around his family without any question. You didn't believe it, just listen to him a few minutes. He would tell you all about his family. It was important to him. But it wasn't just his family that was important. His church family was equally important. And he would talk about his church family with equal fervor. He was committed to the element of family, both his personal family and his church. And his service to this church is commendable. He was a faithful member here for years and years and served as deacon and Sunday school superintendent and was diligent in everything that he did through his service here. But then his service went beyond the walls of this church, serving as a Gideon, and we'll hear about that in just a moment. Serving in leadership everywhere he could and serving faithfully everywhere he went. He was also known by so many folks as friend. I was privileged to be not only his pastor, but to be his friend. And that's important. Somehow or another, we are losing the concept of friend in our society today. He was a true friend. As we focus on the fact that he was here rather than the fact that he was gone, think about things that you did together. Think about the good times that you shared. And think about some of those difficult times that you endured. And realize that we're all better because of having walked in his shadow. We're all better because of having known him as family or friend. So hold on to your memories of Milton. For if you do, then you'll have a part of him with you for the rest of your lives. It's the fact that he was here, not the fact that he's gone, that's important. Dr. Vance Havner made a statement. He said, God uses broken things. It was broken soil to produce a crop. It takes broken clouds to give rain. Broken grain to give bread. And broken bread to give strength. That passage reminds us of the realities that we face in life sometimes. Disappointments and difficulties can serve to break us. But it's then that God chooses to bring out the best in us. And whatever it was in Milton's life that seemed to break him, he always managed to turn it around and some good would come out of it and he would make others better because of it. So as you face today, family, it may seem to break you, but like Milton, let it make you stronger. Let it make you better. Let it make you what God wants you to be.
He called you whenever storm love's given. We call on him to light our darkest day. Why must it be that only when we're lonely and hopes are dim, we call on him? Why don't we call on him before we lose our way? To count our blessings and thank him while we may. We call on him when no one else will answer. We ask of him a reason to go on. When our cup of joy becomes a cup of sorrow, filled to the brim, we call on him. Why don't we call on him before we lose our way?
to count our blessings and thank Him while we live.
Let us pray. Dear precious Heavenly Father, when we come before you, just giving thanks, Lord. Your inerrant word tells us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 that we ought to be thankful in all circumstances and not for all circumstances. And Lord, you are exactly right, because we are not thankful here today, Lord. We're not thankful for this. We are thankful in knowing you and knowing that you are in control. Father, I just thank you that as your word also tells us that when two or more gather in your name, there you shall be also. We welcome you into our midst, because Father, frankly, we need you here today. And I thank you for your presence. And in the coming days, Father, I just pray that you would draw near to each and every person, particularly this family, as they begin their series of tomorrows. Just praying that you will meet those needs as only you can, that you would grant them that peace that transcends all understanding. Father, it is in your perfect, precious, and holy name that I do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, thank you all for being here today. This crowd is certainly a testament to Milton and to his family. Very obviously, in more normal times, these walls cannot contain this crowd, nay, probably not even this parking lot. Not everyone knows of Tabor's location. Some people rode up and down the road for quite some time trying to find it. And as Milton was fond of saying, that there are some places that even the GPS couldn't get you to. And he pointed that out to us quite often. In fact, we would hear it getting ready for an annual meeting every year. Milton had a lot of sayings that he was fond of. I call them Miltonisms, and I often joke with him about them. It just was something that I did trying to get a rise out of him. But today, I'm not joking. As I've given much thought to Milton over the last few days, lots of things spring to mind. Some old songs that I only remember hearing like in Bible school, Almond Christian Soldier. That describes him perfectly. Some verses of scripture that just come to mind. 2 Timothy 4:7. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Hebrews 12:1. In part, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Matthew 25:23. Must be said. His master replied, well done, thy good and faithful servant. No doubt this phrase has been uttered countless times over the times of history as people have entered into those pearly gates. I assure you, it was stated again this past Sunday. There can be no doubt. It says here that in every endeavor that he gave it his all. That was oh so right. There can be no doubt. And sometimes I picked at him and told him that he was like an old pit bulldog, that once he bit into something, he would not let it go. And I couldn't even get a rise in. He would just give me that little sideways grin and say, I know. And it was oh so true. He loved his church, as it says in his obituary service here. He even bragged on his pastor of over 40 years. He was proud of him. He did indeed love his family. He was quick to brag on each and every one. And I can't see Bess, but he liked to brag on her piano playing. He loved his boys' business and bragged on that. He absolutely loved his grandchildren, and especially those great-grandchildren. And guys, you nailed it. He was big. I think you had that absolutely right. He was big in stature. He was big in personality, in love, in devotion, in service, in dependability, and in life. Occasionally, he would even brag on Jeanette. He would let something slip that she had done something for one of our monthly meetings. And all the while, we knew that she was behind the scenes, behind every good man. In this case, certainly, that was Jeanette. In the bulletin here, it says that he was a Gideon since 1985, and that is true, but what it doesn't say, he was one of the few charter members of the local Gideon Wilkes Lincoln camp. And true to form, he gave it his all, from beginning to end. A number of years ago, I attended a Gideon membership recruitment dinner where I heard the phrase, A number one Gideon. It spoke of how you could become a Gideon and then become a qualified speaker. You could participate in distributions like at the University of Georgia that we do every fall. by visiting elementary schools and passing out the orange testaments, the New Testaments. And by the way, Milton was a stickler for having the right color to be handed out to the right people. There could be no mistake about that. He was always one of the faithful ones to visit the doctors and lawyers' offices. And it talked about this A number one thing, and it also said that in some places you would go and get out the Bibles into the lawyer, into the hotels and the motels, that you become a camp officer, that you could become a state officer. And it just goes on and on and on about all these different things you could do. And interestingly, this entire listing was presented to not scare potential members off, because the point they were trying to make was you didn't have to be all those things. You could be one of those things or two of those things, because not everybody is well suited for doing everything I just mentioned here. Sometimes just one thing might be the calling that a person had that they needed to do to serve the Gideons, and we still welcome them because they would be a valuable member to the ministry of the Gideons. But then there was Milton. In the work industry, you often hear the phrase, walk the talk, which basically says, don't just give lip service. Well, that was Milton. He never asked anyone to do something that he wasn't already doing himself. Never. He, more than anyone I know, personified the A number one Gideon description. He was an excellent Gideon report giver, speaker. He always participated in the UGA distributions. He always went with the elementary school distributions and to the doctors and lawyers' offices and to the hotels and the motels. And he always was a leader in the annual pastor's appreciation banquet that is coming up very soon. The local camp officer, he was our president more times than technically he was supposed to be. But he still was there leading the charge. And even when he wasn't, he was the vice president and still being the backbone. He also filled the state position. He was known throughout the state of Georgia as being an A number one Gideon. I think you get the picture. But with him, it was so much more. The planning for the monthly meals that took place every month, the phone calls about them calling different people, reminding them, asking them to come, begging them to come, the annual membership dues, begging people to renew. Calling me for updated membership rosters from the international website. He left no stone unturned. A number one Gideon. He was a Gideon's Gideon. An absolute role model for how it could best be done. And without doubt, a fine mentor for new people joining the Gideon ranks. He will not, in our lifetimes, be forgotten. I say, well done, thy good and faithful friend. Milton's body will be laid to rest right out here today until such time that it is raised incorruptible. Until that time, his soul is present with his Lord. As with most of the grave markers out there, there will be a birth date and there will be a death date. And in between those two is the dash. I told Jeanette a few days ago, the dash is what our lives consist of. The things that we did, those that we knew, and even more importantly, those we touched. Milton's dash stands for a great, great deal. Much is mentioned in the Bible verses that I read a few minutes ago. So I'm compelled to ask you today, what will you have your dash stand for? What is it to mean at some yet undetermined time in the future? I will see Milton again. Many, if not all here today, will also see Milton again. That is the profound hope that we have in Christ Jesus. If you don't know this in your heart of hearts, for you, today is a gift. That's why it's called the present. Fix it. Milton would have it so. Family, our prayers go with you today and in the coming days. Thank you for having me.
Says, for as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Two things I'd remind you of. First of all, death's inevitable. Our being here today is just a reminder. It's coming to us all. Scripture says it's inescapable. It's no respecter of persons. And that's a negative thought. And that can cause us to despair and be discouraged. But let me remind you of a greater fact. And that greater fact is our God's omnipotent. Our God's all-powerful. He's always near and he's ever-present and he's more powerful than this thing we call death. And it's he who cares for us, and especially in enduring our times of sorrow. So from those two facts, the fact that death's inevitable, the greater fact that God's omnipotent, comes a challenge for us as family and as friends. And that challenge is for us to be dependent. To depend upon God as our creator and our sustainer and our redeemer. And to depend upon his strength, resigning our strength to his power. And resting in his promise to sustain us, regardless of our circumstance. For it was Jesus who said, "I'll never leave you nor forsake you." And it was Jesus who said, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." And so I encourage you, family, and I encourage you, friends. Exercise a definite and a deliberate faith in God and in the fact that he loves you. Exercise a definite and a deliberate faith in Christ and what he accomplished at Calvary to help take some of the sting out of today. And to exercise a definite and deliberate faith in the Spirit of God who's able to comfort you and give you peace. Paul to the Ephesian church said, "Be strong." That's not where he put the period. He didn't leave us to try to figure out how to be strong. He said, "Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might." I hope you find strength as you look to God and depend on him to see you through the day and through the difficult days that lie ahead. Horatio Spafford faced tremendous tragedy in his life. He lost his business in the Great Chicago Fire of 1871, and his business dwindled during the economic depression that followed for 2 years. He sent his wife on a ship with the children back to England. Their ship collided with another ship. And later on, he received a telegram, "Saved alone," from his wife, meaning that his children had perished. All four of his daughters had died in that crash. He boarded a ship in England. And upon reaching the area where the tragedy had occurred, the captain of the ship brought him up, and he stood on the deck of that ship looking out across those waters. And the words of the familiar hymn came to him. "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ hath regarded my helpless estate and hath shed his own blood for my soul. And Lord, haste the day when faith shall be sight and clouds be rolled back like the scroll. The trump shall resound and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. I believe with all my heart Milton's message to you as his family would be, it's well with my soul. He took pride in everything that he did, and especially on Sunday morning, when the Sunday school hour would be over, he took pride in bringing that baby. And I couldn't pass up that opportunity.
Thousands of people were fed.